brothers and sisters, from Howard Senior.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the privilege that we have to come into your house to celebrate in your presence. And Lord, as we gather together to hear from you, I pray that you open our hearts and open our minds. Cast away from us all heaviness and cause your light to shine, that our eyes will be open and that your word will indeed come back to your people. So may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be accepted in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. And God's people say,
Amen. Amen.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. As the leader has mentioned, I'm not brother. It's interesting, yesterday, we're on the way to the funeral. I had the privilege, by the way, of driving here. So we're a few people. And we're talking about watchfulness as a theme. And we're going to ask, so how do you manage to hear a message so often? I mean, what kind of process do you have to go through? And, you know, he was explaining that this, you really never stop doing preparation. And the truth is, oftentimes, you tend to underestimate just that work, just doing one message. And I'm saying, you know, sometimes, when I'm talking about 3 weeks and 2 weeks before, I'm going to say something I didn't know that too. So as a good turn out, when we're back to Kingston, as Rabbi said, we got a call that brother was here. And he said, he don't hear you. So to God be the glory, we have to be ready in season and out of season. So what I want to speak to us today about is joy to the world, a king is born. Joy to the world, a king is born. And please have something handy to write. Joy to the world, a king is born. And I'll just be referencing the scriptures that were read earlier. And what I want to present is an evidence-based case for Christmas. I know we all believe it. Are you sure? Do you have proof about that? And what does it mean to you? So let's look at Matthew chapter 2. And after this, by God's grace, Christmas will never be the same. Matthew chapter 2, verse 1. Are you all there? You have to walk with me through the scriptures now. Matthew chapter 2, verse 1. Now, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judah, in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men came from the east to Jerusalem. Brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to be looking at the case. Verse 1 of chapter 2 says, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem. So whatever you're going to read in the rest of chapter 2 happened when? After Jesus was born. We can agree on that?
Yeah.
Alright. So after Jesus was born, and he told us, he tells us the location. He was born in Bethlehem of Judea, the same Judah in the Old Testament. So he was born in Bethlehem of Judah in the days of Herod the king. So this is the setting for the story now. Herod was the king. He's the one that was ruling. And the wise men came to Jerusalem and they came to see Herod. What this means, the wise men came, but they didn't come to Bethlehem. They came to Jerusalem. Why would they come to Jerusalem? The wise men came to the capital city where the seat of government was. So let it be said then that this visit by the wise men was a visit to the government. It's what we call an official state visit. That's what it is. You ever stop to wonder why when your friends come from abroad and come to see you, it's not called a state visit? It's not called an official visit? It's just friends and relatives? But when someone comes from abroad and come to see the government, it's a state visit. Isn't it interesting? Did you know that if you are having a birthday party and you invite me and my wife, it's just a state party? But if you ever invite the Governor General, it's a state affair. It's the people that make the occasion, that lifts the quality of the occasion. In other words, Once you're going to invite the Governor General, total calls change. Hello? Proper RSVP has to be done. Orders, seats have to be reserved. Are you with me?
Yes.
It's not just a private party anymore. So it's the presence of someone that makes the occasion what it is. Why am I saying all of that? We're gathered here in the house of God. If we're just gathering to shake hands when we sing the fellowship choruses, that would be fine. But we're gathering in the presence of a king. What does this, what does it make this space then? A court. A court. So that's why the psalm says, enter into his courts with thanksgiving. And it is gates with thanksgiving, and it is courts with praise. Because God is resident in this space. Are you with me? So you're not in an ordinary space. And that's the reason why when you're gonna preach, you just stand up. I'm not saying you have to. I'm just saying though, you honor the occasion by dressing. I intend to dress for the occasion. Anyway, Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judah. The wise men came to Jerusalem. And Herod was king. And what is interesting is verse 2. And this, I believe, is a part of the Christmas story that maybe is the most said, most believed, and most overlooked. Verse 2. The wise men came saying, where is he who has been born King of the Jews? Just pause a second. Where is he who has been born King of the Jews? Now, brothers and sisters, that's an ordinary statement. How can someone be born a king? You can be born a prince. You can be born heir apparent. You can be born designate to the throne. But how can someone be born a king? I said that to wow. Because that presents a kind of uniqueness that cannot be found anywhere else on earth. There are stories in Egypt and Indian, Greek, Greece and so on, of virgin births and resurrections and so on. But there is no evidence of someone being born a king. So, what then is the significance of this? What's the import of this? Well, it seems to be significant enough to evoke the kind of reaction we see in verse 3 of Matthew chapter 2. It says, when Herod the king heard these things, he was troubled. And not just Herod, and all Jerusalem with him. So my question is, I understand Herod might be troubled, because Herod is king, and between verse 1 and verse 3, we heard that Herod is the king twice, just in case I missed it. So Herod is king, and Herod is getting news that a king has been born. Herod, as a king, knew exactly what that meant. Because two kings can't reign in one kingdom. So Herod knows that this is the kind of language that in our modern day speech we call regime change is impending. Are you with me? Yeah. So why would the rest of Jerusalem be troubled also? Well, when the elephants fight, it's the grass that gets trampled. So the people know that if there is a war, they are going to suffer. Their lives are going to be disrupted. So it wasn't just Herod's concern. News spread. And it's interesting to note that this was a private state meeting. So how did everybody else know? The same way we would know. They have a private government that just squeeze into something. They send it on WhatsApp. They send it around. But in those days, it was word of mouth. But suffice it to say, word got out and everybody was agitated, because this was an imminent act of war that was declared. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? So when we talk about we're engaged in a spiritual war, we make it sound like it's figurative. We're actually a part of a kingdom whose sole intention is to replace an existing order. Oh my God. To the point where you can't even be friends with the world. Because just that allegiance alone makes you enmity. Put your enmity with God. When Herod heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. So let's interrogate this thought of a king being born. So we're saying that a person cannot be born a king according to our logic unless they were a king before they were born. That's what I believe makes sense of the evidence. Are you with me? So unless you had the kingdom before, you could not be born a king. Are you with me? So that puts us in a little challenge. Because now, we would need to find the evidence that suggests that Jesus was really the king of a kingdom that he got before he was born. So Jesus made a particular statement. And before I go to that statement, let me just explain something to you. Do you remember the conversation that God had with Jeremiah? When God called Jeremiah to go, Jeremiah said, "Oh, I'm just a child." And God says, "Before you were born, I called you and set you apart." What? So Jeremiah wasn't born to become a prophet. He was born a prophet already. So there is precedent in the case here. There's precedent in the case. There is some kind of consistency that we're seeing that people or a person was born in a particular state. So that was Jeremiah. So here, Jesus is going to make a statement. Write it down. Luke 22, verse 29. And I want you to listen to this statement because it has implication for Christmas and the joy that was announced to the world. Luke chapter 22, verse 29. If you are there, just say amen. Jesus is speaking to his disciples and he says, "And I bestow or confer on you a kingdom just as my Father bestowed one upon me." Oh Lord. This is Jesus talking now. Jesus said to his disciples, "I bestow on you a kingdom," or "I confer on you a kingdom just as my Father bestowed or conferred one on me." Let's go back to English class for a second. "Behold, I confer on you a kingdom." Confer, what tense is that? Present. "Just as my Father bestowed," past tense. So if the Father bestowed a kingdom on him, when did he get it? Before, whenever time he was speaking. Are you with me? The evidence does not suggest that any time between when Jesus was born and this point, he got any kingdom. Let's follow the evidence up. Are you with me? So Jesus is saying he was conferred with a kingdom, and that kingdom is what he's conferring on his disciples. Now, we don't really understand what that means until we get the import of that word confer. What does it mean to confer something? Well, for those of us who have attended university, you will understand what confer means. When you get a degree, it will say so-and-so has fulfilled all the requirements for the course of study, and on the approval of the Senate, you have been conferred with the degree of bachelor's, doctor's, whatever the case might be. So when you go to the university, having fulfilled all the requirements of study, the university confer its authority on you. And you can take that piece of paper and apply for a job in a suitable field. And you know what's powerful about it? You have a document that confers knowledge on you. And when you go for employment, The employer doesn't ask to see any piece of your coursework. Are you okay? They don't ask to see any of your assignments. They don't ask to see your notebook. They don't ask to see anything. They trust that piece of paper because that paper is the instrument by which you were conferred with the knowledge. And so you walk and move under the authority of that. So if the paper say confers doctor on you, doctor of medicine, it means patients can see it. All they want is to see the new one. Are you with me? And your name carries the title, Dr. So-and-so. Are you with me? So this kingdom was conferred. Now you have to understand what means to confer. Let us say we're all students at a university. And the Senate is conferring degrees. Now, did you know that every student can get a first class honors degree if they work for it? You know that, right? Now, it doesn't matter how many first class degrees are issued, it doesn't depreciate the value of the next. So, because you get a first class degree, doesn't make mine any less valuable. Are you with me? By the way, that's a plug for students. You don't share at school. You all get 100. You all get 100. So, when you confer a degree, so a university can confer as many degrees as there are students who can take the course and successfully pass it. So, when you confer something, you give full authority over. But the thing remains with the one who confers it. So the University of the West Indies confers a degree, a bachelor's degree to you, yet the University of the West Indies is not short of bachelor's degree. That's interesting. That's what it means to confer something. So if a kingdom is conferred on you, I can give you the entire authority of the kingdom and still have the kingdom. You understand what I'm saying? Can I be brother, brother, sister, hold me. Are you with me?
Yes.
So, that's how the kingdom is transferred. It's conferred or it's bestowed. Let me give you an example. In the Old Testament, in Exodus 28, when God was giving Moses the instruction to build the garments of the priests, God instructed Moses to build what's called an ephod. H-O-D, an ephod. And the ephod had two stones, two onyx stones, or onyx stones, on the shoulder straps. And the shoulder straps would have the two onyx stones on the shoulder. And on each stone was engraved the names of the children of Israel, six on each shoulder. And read Exodus 28, write it down when you go home. And it says, so that the son of Aaron might bear the names of the children of Israel as a memorial before God. So the question then is, what's the significance of that? What was the function and role of the priest? Well, the priest's role was ceremonial, but the priest's role was also judicial. What do I mean? The law was something that the priest also handled and adjudicated. The law that relates to things happening inside the temple, that's ceremonial. The law that relates to how people live outside, those are civil laws as well. Are you okay? One law. Now, the priests were the ones that were designated to rule. There were no kings when they were going to the wilderness. And how did they rule? They ruled by using or adjudicating the law. And how did they carry the government? How did they carry the government before God? On their? Oh, Lord. The priests would carry the government of the people on their? So they get somewhere. So, the monarchy in England copied that. It didn't start there. So, if the Queen of England wants to confer some authority on someone, the crown will have an occasion, a coronation, and they'll invite the person close, and the queen or her designate will use a sword, the symbol of rule, scepter, symbol of power. Symbol of rule, and she would tap the person on both. Look up before the battle, brothers. We have the original blueprint. And so, with that tap, with those two taps on the shoulder, those two taps means you're carrying the government on your shoulder. So therefore, when you see or refer to the gentleman, you can't call him Mr. Allen. He's Sir Allen, because he has been tapped. If you say somebody's tapped for that position, that's what they mean. Somebody has pre-selected them as designates. That's where the word comes from. You've been tapped for that position. So the queen with two taps can make an ordinary person head of state. And that's why the governor general is the head of state. So the prime minister needs to report to the head of state, which is the governor general, which is the queen's designate. And she does it by putting the government on his shoulders. So, it seems to me that, so, and you can carry, there's a designate called the OBE, the Order of the British Empire. When you have that designation, when you go to an airport in any of the Commonwealth territory, they open the gates for you and put you in diplomatic treatment. Because it's the same process, you're carrying the entire empire on your shoulder. When they see you and open your passport, they have to clear the way for you. Just two taps on the shoulder. So, let's go back to the scripture that was already earlier, Isaiah 9. Because we think that Christmas is about a little baby. Brothers and sisters, salvation is a man-sized job. It just started with the baby because the baby had it before he was born. So every Christmas we put Jesus back into manger and worship him and strut. That's not the idea. Salvation is a man-sized job. Let's hear what Isaiah chapter 9 has to say. Verse 6, that was read earlier. Isaiah 6, are you there? Just say amen if you are. Amen? Alright, let me take some more time. Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. For unto us a child is born. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is, and here's the troublesome part, and they shall be, that can make sense now? Okay. The government shall be upon his shoulder. So you're talking about a child who was born carrying a government. I know sometimes we believe that it's because Herod was harassing him, why was the government upon his shoulder? But the truth is, he was born with a carrying a government. And his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Then hear what verse 7 says, just in case we missed it in verse 6. Of the increase of his government and peace there will be no end. And just in case you missed what it's about, it links it back upon the throne of David and over his kingdom. This is a king talking about. The child that we're talking about, that Isaiah spoke of in Isaiah 9, is a king that was born. Not a civilian. And he's going to order and establish the kingdom. So the question that we need to find out. So if I was presenting this case to you and you're the jury, you then would be asking, so, lead prosecutor, you have been saying that for somebody to be born a king, they have to get it before, and you're giving us examples of this. We're seeing now where it says the government is on his shoulder, so you would need now to show me where Jesus was given a kingdom, isn't it? So let's hear what evidence is. And Bronson says, all of this evidence is leading up to one thing, you know. which is the reason for Christmas and why we have joy to the world. So, Daniel gave us a glimpse of this. Daniel chapter 7, write it down. Daniel chapter 7, we just got two verses there. Initial. Verses 9 to 10 and 13 and 14. Daniel chapter 7, verses 9 to 10, 13, and 13 to 14. Write it down, but I'll read. I watched, Daniel was speaking, I watched till thrones were put in place, and the Ancient of Days was seated. His garment was white as snow, and the hair of his head was like pure wool. His throne was a fiery flame, its wheels a burning fire. Let's just pause for a second. Daniel said he watched until thrones were put in place. We're talking about a royal gathering, and thrones were put in place. And he saw and used the term the Ancient of Days. The first day we know of in the Bible is Genesis chapter 1. Daniel saw someone who predated the first day. So he said, Ancient of Days. And it says here was white as wool. No. It says that, and it mentioned that his throne, who sits on a throne? A king. So naturally, we know who the Ancient of Days is in terms of his position. He's a king. And it says his throne had wheels on it. Have you ever heard the term a high roller? In Las Vegas, they talk about a high roller, or somebody who is living a flash lifestyle called a high roller. Well, Isaiah saw the Lord high and lifted up on his throne. And the train of his robe filled the temple. Well, that is giving us some more information. That throne that is so high had wheels on it. So here, Daniel saw the Ancient of Days, and he described his throne. And it goes on to say, verse 10, a fiery stream issued from forth before him. A thousand thousands ministered to him. 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The court was seated, and the books were open. Chapter 10, verse 9 tells that the Ancient of Days was seated in them. So there were thrones, and then, as you know, the official person comes in last, right? So everybody is sitting. They're all kings because their thrones were set in place. But one king, he sat down. Thousands upon thousands were there. And now books were open. You're talking about a royal occasion, brothers and sisters. But what is the significance of this? The answer is found in the next verses, verse 13 and 14. Make sure you don't miss this enough. Verse 13. I was watching in the night visions, and behold, one like the Son of Man, coming with the clouds of heaven. He came to who? The Ancient of Days. So, can you imagine the court seated, the Ancient of Days, on his throne, high and lifted up, and the Son of Man came to him. And continues by saying, and they brought him, the Son of Man, near before him. You don't realize the coronation taking place? You don't realize? Okay. Let's see what the evidence says. The very next verse tells us, and to him was given dominion and glory and a say it like a sure enough. And a
kingdom.
That all peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion, exactly as Isaiah said, which shall not pass away, and his kingdom the one which shall not be destroyed. Evidence presented. So he was born a king. This is very important, the Bible says, because for years I used to worship a Jesus who is going to be king one day when he comes back. I'm telling you. So he's not yet king, he's just heir apparent. So his power is not manifested yet. His power is going to be manifested when he breaks through the clouds of heaven and come with his armies. No! He is king already, and the kingdom is already here, and he came to give you access and an inheritance in that kingdom in real time. You don't have to die and resurrect to go into this kingdom. Are you with me? He goes as far as saying in Luke 17:20, the kingdom of God don't come by observation. They say, look here or look there. For behold, the kingdom of God is within you. Yes, Luke 17:20, write it down. Luke 17:20, the kingdom of God is within you. And let me just take a minute to just explain what that is saying, you know. Let me ask you a question. When you travel overseas, is it very difficult to identify someone who is a Jamaican? I don't think so. So the way they dress, the way they talk, what they eat, their mannerisms, right? And Jamaicans, I don't know if we're unique among us, but we are the kind of person who, no matter how cold it is, if we're having drinks, I seem to be in it. And we just shake because I'm here shaking. Sub-zero degree weather outside, no matter. Drinks, ice. Are you with me? It's not quite the same for us Jamaicans. Are you with me? So, you recognize that someone is Jamaican when you see them outside of Jamaica. But the question I'm going to ask you is this. That which you use to recognize them as Jamaican, did they carry it to America in their suitcase? Did they carry it in their purse? Did they carry it in their handbag? So how did it get over there for you to identify them with it? They brought it inside of them. And everything they do manifests it. If they talk, it comes out. If they want something to eat, it comes out. If they're going to dress, it comes out. If they're going to go somewhere, it comes out. Because Jamaica is inside of them. Are you with me? But what happens is, if you're in Jamaica, you really don't see much of a difference. So when someone says you have an accent, you don't recognize it when you're among Jamaicans. Are you with me? Because you're among your own people. But when you go outside, people say, hey, you have a very interesting or nice accent. You see, when you are among your kind, you can't see. You don't. You see, the thing is, when you take that airplane and go to the United States, you did not know anything different enough other than the suitcase. So Jamaica was always inside of you. But when you're among your kind, it is not so easy to make the distinction. So if someone say, I speak with an accent, you'd be like, I don't think so. I can understand how fairly well. So here's the thing then. If I am living, if I am from Jamaica, work with me. If I am from Jamaica and I migrate to live in the United States, that's when you will recognize that Jamaica is inside of you. So as long as I'm living outside of my home of abode, my resident domicile, then I carry within me the place that I am from. And that is why the kingdom of God is inside of you, because the kingdom of God is not from here. It's from somewhere else. So you are in a foreign land, and we are strangers and pilgrims. And so when somebody looks at you, they say, no, you're not from here. You don't dress like us, you don't talk like us, you don't behave like us. It's a different set of laws governing your life. Are you with me? Yeah, that's what it means. The kingdom is inside of you. I challenge you. Look at all the parables of Jesus. What was he talking about? The kingdom of God. This is not no fake, it's not a figurative analogy. It is real. Oh God, we have always been repeating to your people. God is not fake. His kingdom is not fake. It is real. It is more real than your body. Because it can outlast your body. Anyway. This issue, so we're going to conclude the case and come to some final, some closing statements. So this issue would be evident at the beginning and at the end of Jesus' earthly life. Write this down. John chapter 18, verses 33 to 36. John chapter 18, verses 33 to 37. Write it down first and look for it after, just in case you don't miss it. And this was Jesus' final, well, his court case in the final phase of his life. And Pilate was the one he was sitting before. And verse 33 says of St. John chapter 18. Then Pilate entered the praetorium again, or the judgment hall, and called Jesus and said to him, "Are you the King of the Jews?" Here is the same question that was made at the beginning of his life is the same question or statement that is being made at the end of his life. It was that significant. Why would it matter? Obviously, there must have been something said about that statement, the King of the Jews, that the King of the Jews was actually born king. So Pilate got an opportunity to interview Jesus. And Pilate is not even weighing the evidence of the case. What was the evidence of the case? They brought Jesus on false charges of blasphemy. And so Pilate wasn't even asking about blasphemy or anything. Pilate got an opportunity. See, Pilate was a king, so he was a ruler, so he understood power. So he wanted to get his answer. And he said, "Are you the King of the Jews?" Jesus never lost his sense of humor, even under great trials and distress. And that's an example for us. Listen to Jesus' response. Jesus answered him, "Are you speaking this of yourself, or did others tell you this about me?" What a time to have a sense of humor. I mean, here is the judge who is ruling your case, questioning your identity. He's asking, "Are you the King of the Jews?" And you're saying, "Your Honor, are you asking me this because you really want to know? Are you asking me this because I hear from somebody else?" And Pilate flew into a rage. Pilate said, "Am I a Jew?" In other words, "It shouldn't concern me. Am I a Jew? Your own nation and the chief priests have delivered you to me. What have you done?" That was the original question that Pilate should have asked. You think that's how the case should have opened? What have you done? What is your side of the story? Jesus just continued the conversation. And Jesus said, "My kingdom." So once you hear someone say, "My kingdom," it must be a king. Hello. Listen to the language he's using. "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants, who is this? If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would fight so that I should not be delivered to the Jews. But no, for no, my kingdom is not from here." Oh God, the headquarters is not here for now. And so those who are in it, you will see the kingdom inside of them because they're not from here either. And that's how you know others who are in the kingdom. You see the kingdom inside of them. It comes out in every aspect of their lives. And so Pilate, being a ruler, getting a reply like that, asked the most logical question. And Pilate asked the question in verse 37. Pilate therefore answered, "Are you a king then?" Naturally, if Pilate listens to the language that he's using, and he's saying, "Are you a king then? Is that what you're saying?" And Jesus said, "You say rightly that I am a king. For this cause I was born like that virgin. And for this cause I came into the world." Jesus wasn't born to make him feel good on Sunday morning and go home. I don't care about anything else. He's telling you why he was born. He came with a government to rule here. The headquarters is not from here at this point. And he came to give people access and inheritance in that kingdom. So Jesus said, you say rightly that I am a king. For this purpose I was born, and for this purpose I came into the world. Why? That I should bear witness to the truth. The truth of what? The truth of this kingdom. So everything Jesus did was evidence that the kingdom is real. So when he healed the sick, gave the blind sight, raised the dead, all of these things were evidence that the kingdom he spoke of is real. Woo! It's real. It's as real as it is evidenced by the words of Jesus. Amen. So that was the concluding part of Jesus' life. And so, as I close, the question would be, yes, I get it. I just think, in order to understand God, approaching the mind of a believing skeptic. You believe or you're skeptical. And so, my question would be, alright, so that was before Jesus died. I mean, we are worshiping a resurrected Savior now. We can accomplish that kingdom business now, Brother Hall. That was before Jesus died. So, I would have to conclude the case at that point, after Jesus was resurrected. What was his conversation about? Are you with me? Because you can't leave it opening in the case. So when the enemy, the accuser of the brethren, come to cross-examine him, you don't have anything to talk about. Wait, Acts chapter 1, you know? As we close. Acts chapter 1. Is everybody all right? Acts chapter 1. Write it down, verses 1 to 3. Verses 1 to 3. Acts chapter 1, verses 1 to 3. The former treatise or account I made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began both to do and to teach, until the day in which he was taken up, after he, through the Holy Spirit, had given commandments to the apostles whom he had chosen, with special attention now, verse 3, by whom he also presented himself alive after his sufferings by many infallible proofs, being seen by them during 40 days, speaking of the things pertaining to the So the resurrected Jesus was concerned and speaking about the things of the kingdom. Are you with me?
Yes.
So insistent was Jesus on this that in verse 6, they asked him, therefore when they had come together, they asked him, saying, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? That was how real it was to the disciples. Will the kingdom be restored at this time? That was how real it was. So Jesus wasn't talking about anything figurative to the people, to his disciples. It was that real. So, as we conclude, all I'm going to do is just read the scripture and close. I want to explain. John chapter 1, write it down. John chapter 1, verses 10 to 13. Just write it down and I will. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, and the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own did not receive him. But as many as received him, to them he gave power or the right to become children of God, even to those who believe in his name. Wow. He came to give us access as children to the kingdom. Who were born not of blood, nor of the will of flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. Brothers and sisters, what does this say? Plain and simple. Jesus came to give us both access to and an inheritance in his kingdom. How do you get access to a kingdom? How do you get access to a kingdom? Well, you will have to declare your allegiance. And that's why when you get citizenship in your country, you have to declare your allegiance. So to as many as received him, to them he gave right. How do you have to receive Jesus? You have to receive him as Lord. As Lord. Now let us pause. It don't mean what you think it means. I'm not making a religious statement. I am making a statement that has waiting for government. In a kingdom, private citizens or subjects don't own anything. Like literally. And I've explained this before. So, as head of state, the queen owns all the land. So all lands are considered crown land. So the queen wants to expand the road through her government, then they give you an offer you can't really refuse. And so we come in some more, over parking, and the road is expanded. So in a kingdom, private citizens can't own private property. It all belongs to the crown. Because in a kingdom, there is only one Lord. Lord means owner. Lord means owner. So if you receive Jesus as Lord, it means everything that you possess or that in your possession belongs to him. Your life, your body, your mind, your strength, everything. Your relationships, your possessions, everything. So that's how you get access to your allegiance. The second thing is about inheritance. You can't inherit a kingdom by just being in it. So, when Queen Elizabeth, her son, Andrew, and her sons, these are the ones who inherit the kingdom. The subjects can enjoy the benefits of the kingdom, but they can't inherit rule of the kingdom. Are you with me? Unless you're in a royal lineage, you have to come, you have to be born into a kingdom in order to inherit rule in it. That's how it is in human affairs, isn't it? Well, it's the same mirror image in God's kingdom. You can't just get in and just come to church every day and you inherit it. No. You have to be born in it. And when we receive him as Lord, he gives us the power to be born again as new persons inside the kingdom with God as our Father. Brothers and sisters, what is born of flesh is flesh. That what is born of spirit is spirit. And it's not by the will of man or the will of flesh. You can't call yourself to be born again. That power has to be given to you by one whom you accept as Lord. And so I conclude. There was no room in the inn for Jesus. Do you have room in your heart for him as Lord this Christmas? That's the question. He is not trying to be king. He already is king. He's not trying to be Lord. He already is Lord. Jesus is not about a feel-good time at the end of the year. This message has import all year round in all areas of your life. Your Father literally is a king. Stop living like a peasant.
Amen.
I'm not talking about prosperity gospel. Hello.
Hallelujah.
I'm not talking about prosperity gospel. Stop living like a peasant.
Yes.
Your Father is a king. How do you talk? How do you walk? How do you live? Are you living royally? We talk about your royal priesthood and carry yourself like slum, like you're living in a slum?
No.
You're an insult to the kingdom if you carry yourself below a certain point. You want to learn a very important lesson? When I used to work in advertising, when the clients would bargain with us and the price go below a certain point, my boss would say, give it for free. Don't charge. Because if you charge for it, you're going to cheapen the value of the work. Are you with me? So when I go shopping, when I go overseas with my wife and so on, I tell her, don't put those cheap things on the clearance rack. You're cheating yourself. So stop buying 10 dresses, buy 3. But look good when you step out. You are the child of a king. You're coming in with 12 dresses that you get 2-for-1 special, and then after 3 weeks they reload and look like rags on you. I'm saying, brothers and sisters, you are a king. You must guide your peers in every area of life. Yes, I'm telling you, and it's not about prosperity gospel. I'm saying your Father is a king. Make room for him in your heart this Christmas, and chose again to make, to give him access to you so that he can give you a new birth and access and inheritance in his kingdom. May God bless you and keep you in this place. The hymn of response.